Okay, listen.
Frankly speaking.
Franklin speaking.
There's a contrast in people's minds, you know, of what women are, what they, you know, that they're beautiful or that they're, you know, whatever imagery that society kind of generally has about women, you know, that they're delicate, that they're this, and then they do something completely the opposite.
Totally.
Then you get the contrast in it. And that's kind of what I think is such an interesting element, you know, where the men don't have, you guys don't have that benefit. You're expected to be brute and badass. And,
well,
you know, I mean,
no,
and that's why a lot of men think that they can fight. Well, I mean, I have some good stories about,
you beating up guys. You have some good stories.
About
beating up.
I used to train with Dennis Hallman. Back in the day, like way when I started my professional career, I lived in a small 22-foot RV on Dennis Hallman's property, and I just trained, like that's what I did, and with two other teammates of mine. And anyway, so the point I was gonna get to is, like, sometimes these guys would walk in to the gym, and mind you, this is not like a gym where we hold cardio kickboxing classes and kids classes. No. This is a fight gym only. It's a barn with padded walls that fighters come to fight each other Monday through Friday, and that's it. And maybe a kids wrestling program, you know, because he was into coaching kids. That's it. So sometimes we'd get these weirdo guys that would come in that's, you know, puffing their chest out, and the kind of men that just think they know how to fight automatically because they
they're men. Yeah.
And he'd be like, okay, partner up with Miesha. And whatever, I'm not going to, you know, with the girl, it's just ridiculous. I'm going to, you know what I mean? And I was like, okay, well, let's see how you do. Let's go with Miesha, you know? And I would just kick the out of them. Like, choke them out. I've choked them unconscious. You know, I've had guys leave like halfway through the practice because they don't want, they're so like demasculated or whatever. Like,
I probably would have done the same thing. Like if I walked in and that happened to me, I would have been like, I'm out. Oh, I do actually have a story like that. There's I train, sometimes I lift at this gym called the Sweatshop in Cincinnati. Really good trainers, and they're all like all these gyms, the Power Station where I did all my training for my camps, and Westside Barbell. I don't know if you've ever heard of them. Very well-known gym out of Columbus. A lot of the training principles in these gyms are all the same. And so I go to Sweatshop one day, and I'm working out, and the female powerlifting team was there training that day. And
you probably realized real quick, bad day to come to the gym and try to bad time.
So what happened was they were doing this benching routine, and I'm jumping in with everybody. Basically what they did is they broke the girls up into two groups, those with longer arms and those with shorter arms. And there were a couple of guys lifting there. I wasn't the only one, but obviously
that was a thing for lifting.
Yeah, because
why is that a thing?
Well, this is my excuse for not having a super strong bench is because my arms are built.
Long?
Yeah, I have almost a 77-inch reach, so they're built for boxing. And that's my excuse. But you know, so I get clumped into the group of women who are typically taller and they have longer arms. And so essentially what you do is you find a starting weight, and then you do, it was a three rep set. So you do three reps, then you add a certain amount of weight on each side. You do three more reps, and you keep adding three more reps, and you just keep going up and going up and going up until you can't do your three reps anymore. And I remember we were all warming up, and we get on the bench, and they're like, all right. And I can't remember what they put on, but they're
it's
like, this
all
is
women
our
women with you.
All women. I'm the only guy in the group.
Okay.
And why
were you in their group?
Because I just happened to show up that day to lift at the time
so
when
like,
the team.
So they're like, come here, let me show
you.
Yeah, well,
because I'm going to do the same
or did
workout.
Did you invite yourself?
See how strong you are.
No, because this was the most, it's like, this is one of those things, you know, where it's like midway through
the
workout.
What, were you trying to pick up chicks or what?
No, trust me. Let me get to the end of my story.
Okay.
So we're doing our warm up sets. We get warmed up, and then they throw the weight on, and I can't remember what the starting weight was. You know, something like maybe like 275. That's the starting weight. And
let's clarify, right?
Yeah, I immediately look at this and I'm like, shit, that's our starting weight? And I knew right away, I knew 100% that I was going to be the first one out on this because it's three reps and then they increase the weight. Then you do three reps and then you increase the weight and you do three reps. And, you know, so it's like I do my three reps, then everybody else does their set of three.
Yeah.
And then you increase the weight. And then we do this round robin. And sure enough, I don't know how many sets in I was, but I was the first one who basically failed at the top end. And I was the weakest guy on the floor that day. Because there's just
it's humbling, isn't it?
Oh, truly, truly.
Wait, humbling. So how did that go down? Like, did you just walk out or?
No, I mean, I knew it. I knew it as soon as I showed up that day. I knew it as soon as I showed up. My buddy Shane, who owns the gym, he looks at me, and goes, "Well, why don't you just jump in with the girls' powerlifting team?" And I was like, "No." No, I'll do my own thing over here. It's okay. I'll get some flies in or something like that. You know,
I'm
just
working on chest day today.
Yeah, no, it's because every day there is just a power day. So yeah, I knew right away. But you know, for me, it doesn't bother me. I mean, you know, I know how this is. There are women on the planet that are faster than me. There are women on the planet that are stronger than me, and so on and so forth as it goes. So you know, I'm not one that's going to. I just had a good laugh about it.
Honestly, frankly speaking, it's one of those things that, you know, women
It's Franklin speaking, Miesha. It's Franklin
speaking. Oh, okay. Oh, my bad. I forgot the name of the show. But frankly speaking, no. women can be stronger and better and kick ass over guys sometimes. So.
Well, so it's funny that you said earlier when you were talking about how when you see that the opposing thing, like when you see girls in lingerie and then suddenly they're able to play an explosive game of football, you know, it was kind of the same thing that you asked me about my pink shorts. Like that was kind of the mentality of tough guys don't wear pink, so I'm going to do the opposite. So there's the bit of that shock factor from the same thing.
Yeah.
But along your comment about the girls in lingerie, I'll say this, and I don't know if this is necessarily a sexist thing, a sexist way of thinking, because I always try to look at things from multiple perspectives as well. Like I always try to think from other people's point of view.
Yeah,
it's difficult to do when you're a man because I don't know what it's like to be a woman. But, you know, for example, if I'm in the Midwest and I pull up next to I'm pulling up next to a truck and it's like this dually diesel truck with a 6-inch lift on it and just, you know, all tweaked out and everything. And as I'm pulling up, I'm like, man, this truck is sweet. And then you pull up next to the truck and you realize there's some girl driving the truck. I'm like, that's badass. Because it's just something
that... I agree, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I don't think it's not necessarily a sexist way of thinking
as
much...
Because it's not typical.
Exactly. And so, you know, it's because on the other side of that, it's like, well, this is the way that society conditions people is that that's not supposed to be normal for a girl. And if it was, I wouldn't have... I mean, obviously wouldn't have an issue with it, but you wouldn't be as shocked every time you saw it either.
Yeah. But it's kind of cool. Like when you see like, you know, a little 98-pound blonde or something hop out of the driver's seat, and you're like, whoa, this is not, it's just not what you expected. I'm the same way. Like I'm like, that's so cool. Like she's driving a big truck. Like I thought some burly man was going to get out of there.
Especially when you pull up next to her and you're like, so you're like, is that a 6-inch lift? You're like, yeah. She's like, well, I had to redo the rear end on this and starts talking about gearing and all that kind of stuff. And
but
like,
she probably knows more than you do about all of it. You're just playing along.
You're like, I just filled my gas up and I checked my oil and it's doing good.
You're like, I have to ask you, Rich, do you still wear pink ever?
All the time.
You do. Okay.
Yeah, it's
maybe
my favorite
I saw
color.
You wear like a salmon colored shirt once, but you're so pink is still, is has it always been a thing for you always? Or is it kind of since that pink endeavor?
No, probably not. Because so when I was younger, I was real little. I was super skinny growing up, all that kind of stuff. I grew up playing football, American football my whole life from the time I was 8 years old to the time I graduated high school. And I dreamed of being in that sport, but I was the runt of my family. My dad's a big, big man, and all the men in my family are big men. I would say of all me, and I have two brothers with my dad. Of the three of us, I'm the smallest of the three. They're just, I'm more chiseled than both of them, and probably if they cut down to my body fat, I would be a lot bigger than them. But at the same time, you could tell they're just thicker frame than me. And I think like growing up, I probably wouldn't have had the confidence at that point in time to pull off the pink. But, you know, when I started training and I got into college and I realized that martial arts was something that I was really good at, it gives you, not that I wasn't it's not that I wasn't confident as a young kid, but you know, as you start getting more and more confident, and I think the more confident I got with my ability, the more you're just able to be like, it's the same thing, you know, going back to the story that I said about the benching with all those girls in the gym. I'm so confident in the things in life that I'm actually good at that I don't care about being outperformed. Like it just doesn't faze me. I'm like, okay, so she can outbench me, and so can she, and so can she, and her too, and her, and her.
See, if only more guys could think like you, it would just be wonderful.
Yeah, I did. Well,
you know what? Rich, I
realize how much better the world would be if everybody was more like me, right?
I don't know if I would go that far.
So pull yourself.
Yeah, you had a good concept. Yeah, you had a good concept there for
and then I had to ruin it with the douchebaggery.
And hey, that's Rich we know.
It wouldn't be you if it wasn't.
Yeah,
there's a day. Is that still a thing in Cincinnati? There was a day named after you, Rich Franklin Day.
Yeah, it was like for February? A year. Yeah, February.
Or just for like a year. So they don't February do it anymore. So you can't like hashtag it on when like February. I think it's February or something.
Yes, February either 12th or 21st. Maybe I don't know. I could, I guess, hashtag it, but I don't know.
I didn't know if it was still a thing. I thought that was cool. I always wanted a day named after me. Like when Holly beat Rhonda, she got like Holly Day, you know, in Albuquerque. I'm like, that's so cool. I wish I had a day named after me. You know,
why did you get a day named after you?
Wait, why?
Because you're awesome.
Why did you get a day named after you? What'd you do?
I don't know. But because.
Or like, what was the occasion?
I lost a bench press contest against a bunch of women, so they named it. No, it was just, I guess, it was the city's way of recognizing accomplishments that I had made. You know, and there was, I think the only other, any kind of true champion in Cincinnati, probably prior to me, no pun on the words here, was Aaron Pryor. I don't think there were any other real well-known boxing. I mean, there's some other champions that had held belts, because I, you know, one of the guys that I worked out with at my boxing school when I was training, he had held the WBC title for, I think, one fight. But no, I think that just, you know, Cincinnati celebrating the fact that there was a world champion in their city. So they named a day after me. The thing is that they didn't tell me it was my day until I came onto a radio talk show at like 7 p.m. that night. So I didn't even get to enjoy the day. And it's not like they said, you know, hey, it's your day, so you can go to the grocery store and get all your groceries for free and eat out at whatever restaurant. Everything's free today. It's Rich Franklin Day. It didn't work like that. So other than just a cool gesture, it's like there was no true benefit to it. Like, oh, I can't reap any benefits here.
All right. Well, hey, it happens to the best of us, I suppose, or not, because I didn't get a day named after me. So,
yeah, no. So, I want to go back to the we were talking about the lingerie league. Did you see where Serena Williams got her the cat suit that she was going to wear for competition got banned? Have you seen that?
No, I had no idea. So she was going to wear a cat suit, like just like a one piece.
Well, they called it a cat suit. It was like it was like a.
Is this the Black Panther thing?
Yeah, it looks like it. Looks like a. Do you have a computer in front of you, Miesha?
Yeah, the one I'm talking to you on. But I have my phone too. I'll look it up.
Yeah, Google Serena Williams cat suit or something.
So they banned her for it, or I mean, not banned her, but banned the suit.
Yeah, it was a. I mean, you can see it. It was
I see it. Yeah.
Yeah. So she was banned for playing in this thing in the French Open.
This one. Yeah.
Hold on. Let me see. Let me
is that it?
To... Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's weird. Why? Because a girl has to wear a skirt to play? Seems weird.
I mean, so it's interesting. I wanted your thought on this, because, you know, when I read about this originally, I thought that It's kind of crazy, you know. I guess their reasoning was that white is the standard outfit I mean that's ultimately I think what they rested behind. But there was some comments made about it being a very fit forming, and perhaps I'm not quoting directly here, but that it was a bit too provocative, so to speak. And so, but then ultimately they rested on the fact that it wasn't white and that's the official uniform color. So I just, but the interesting thing is that, you know, they talk about it being a bit too provocative, but when you look at what female tennis players play in, it's not, yeah. They're not exactly dressed like Amish people or something like that, you know? No.
Far from it.
Yeah.
That is really strange. I think that's a more of a cover up than anything. I would love to see her come out in a white one and see what they think. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't see any problem with what, you know, what she's wearing. I mean, I didn't know that was the thing. I'm still looking at it because I'm comparing some of her other outfits or whatever, but I didn't know that was a thing for it to be white, quote unquote, that's the official uniform color. But I don't know if that would have mattered, you know, if she'd come out in a white one, you know what I mean? They probably still would have had a problem with it. It's just change, you know, a change in a sport that they think they've already got figured out and they want women to conform a certain way. She didn't do that. So I really, I mean, that would be my first instinct. I'm not real read up on this, so I can't say, but that just, it doesn't seem, you know, especially if the commentary is coming out that this is provocative. I'm like, and so a mini skirt is not.
Yeah.
Do you, like, but what if a man came out like,
exactly. That's what I was going to say. Do you think that there'd be the same issue?
Oh, I mean, It would probably be a different kind of backlash. You know what I mean? I don't know if there would be the same issue. I mean, if a guy, so you're saying like if a guy was wearing like a skin tight cat suit, people would probably be up in arms for a different reason. But I wonder if it would be banned. That I don't know. You know what I mean? Because guys typically wear shorts. Do they ever wear pants to play tennis in?
I haven't seen. I don't think I've seen one either.
But shorts. But I think there are people that wear shorts with compression. There are players with compression pants under their shorts.
I got you.
But I just wonder if there would have been this. If you think there would have been the same reaction, if a man had done that, you know, that's because that was my initial thought. Like, what would happen if this was, you know, a well-known male tennis player, Roger Federer, or something like that?
Oh man, that's a good question. I don't exactly have the answer for that, but I mean, I feel like the backlash wouldn't have been the same. You know what I mean? Like, I think sometimes when, especially someone like Serena Williams, who's very full figured and she's very confident and strong in her body, like sometimes it's just like threatening. Like people don't want, you know, always women to like exude that kind of strength or confidence. And it seems like she's had a bit of, turbulence throughout her career. And, you know, she has kind of like, I'm not quoting her, but, you know, like self-proclaimed that you know a lot of it has to do with her being a strong, empowered Black woman, you know, and that she gets a lot of backlash because of that. So I mean, there's definitely two sides to look at this, and really interesting to think about, like if a guy were to do that, like what kind of I mean, I'm sure if he was wearing all, I bet you if he was wearing black like a cat suit, but then had like just a t-shirt and the shorts over it, you know, like a white, I don't think it would be the same at all. I mean, I can't bring myself to think that just because if he would want to wear something that was compression, it's, you know, just form fitting and it's different than what people are used to seeing. And I think that's probably the biggest issue.
You know, when you talk about marketing a sport, and we talked about the lingerie league, and obviously that's just, you know, pun intended here, a league of its own. But when you talk, when you think about the way
that, you keep bringing that up, Rich. I'm just stuck on that.
I might watch a game after we're done talking today. Right. You've inspired me. No, but when you look at the way that, say, male athletes and female athletes are marketed, but how much of a role does sex or sexuality like play in that? And I guess I don't know. I guess a second part of that question to you would be, you know, was there, when you were competing, was there pressure on you to do, you know, things like photo shoots to kind of, you're not just selling the fight as much as you're like kind of with the sexuality of things or anything like that? Like, is there a pressure there with female athletes?
Wait, you mean you didn't have pressure like that?
Not really.
No, really? No pressure to put on the Valley Tudo shorts and go topless? No.
Well, but that's.
I guess I'm alone in this then.
Hold on. I mean, we just to kind of clarify things. I mean, for example, I wouldn't walk around a beach with bodybuilding, you know, like what a standard outfit would be for bodybuilding. But if I was in a bodybuilding contest, that would be the standard uniform. And so everybody's doing the same thing. It's one thing when you're competing in the outfit, but I'm talking about like the marketing leading up to it, like different photos. Like I was never put in any kind of photo shoots where it's like, let's show the sexy side of Rich.
Right.
Did you feel like they did that for you as a female?
I'm just giving you a hard time, Rich. I knew your answer was going to be no. Yeah. No offense.
No, but you know what? Actually, you spun that back to me as if like, you know, you're shirtless and you're in Valley Tudo shorts and they're tight. And how do you not like it's and it's yeah. true. But when it's when something's in context,
I'm just highly surprised that nobody asked you to promote yourself that way. No, I'm just kidding. No, seriously, though, it is different and certainly was different for women and still is, you know, but that's just it's. I mean, do you think that a woman would sell toothpaste the same as a man would, you know, if they're marketing an article? I mean, it's weird how we have come to market. Maybe it's not weird, like market men and market women, you know, it's just one of those things that I feel like women can play to a different type of marketing, you know, a different strategy when it comes to marketing. So would I say that I felt like No, I don't want to say pressure, but I would say opportunity. I had a lot of opportunity where I don't think that guys would necessarily have that to do those kinds of photo shoots. I remember my first photo shoot that was somewhat controversial or, you know, like my parents were kind of like, ooh, you know, my boyfriend was kind of like, eek. It was a Fight magazine. You know, and I had like booty shorts, like boy shorts, like the underwear, the boy short cut underwear.
Yeah.
So it was like bottom half of the butt cheeks were showing. And otherwise, like I had like a jacket that was kind of, I had like a bra on, but it was a strapless bra and you couldn't really even see that, you know, but the photos, you know, are obviously to kind of like show off the body. And those were opportunities that would present themselves, you know, left and right. I did the body issue, you know, which was all nude, but I know that they do that for the guys as well too, you know, the body issue, but certainly, I mean, I think I kind of understood though, that it was like, it was a smart tactic for me to market myself as feminine as possible. And it's not that it was not something that, was natural to me anyways. It's not like I was like, you know, selling my soul to the devil and becoming something I wasn't, you know, it's like, I was girly. I did wear dresses and skirts and high heels. And part of the reason why I got the nickname Cupcake, you know, because people thought that I was, not good. I mean, you know that, I mean, you guys know in combat sports, you don't want to be referred to as the cookie on the team or the cupcake on the team. It's kind of like, you know, that's like the weenie. That's the one that like, you don't want to be that one, the soft one on the team.
I guess I would maybe hold a different kind of, meaning for the guy on the team being called Cupcake. And maybe that's just a sexist comment, an ignorant comment, not sexist, but an no, ignorant comment on I my mean, part.
Because
your mindset
right.
about your and mindset and about you, competing your, is,
go ahead. In your way of thinking about it, Rich, you're right because you are a man. And so that's how you have, that's your firsthand perspective. But my firsthand perspective as a woman, like to be called the Cupcake is not any better. You know what I mean?
Because it's you're like, competitive just like me.
Yeah. I'm like, yeah, exactly. Oh, she's sweet. Oh, she's cute. Like we don't take her serious. She's just a little cupcake, you know? And you're like, like, you know, like, wait, no, you have to take me serious, you know, like F you, like I work just as hard. Like, you know, like put me in there. Like I'm ready to go. I'll prove myself, you know? And it definitely still puts a chip on my shoulder, you know, like to think of it that way. It's like, I want to prove like, I'm not the cupcake, you know what I mean? And that was kind of the irony of it is like, I hated that at first. I did not like being underestimated. It pissed me off but it motivated me. And I also found, you know, a synergy with it. And then I started to really embrace it. I was like, all right, fine. I was like, you want to underestimate me? That's fine. I was like, lock me in the cage, lock me in the ring, lock me in the whatever, you know, and let's see who the cupcake is.
Yeah, I think in the end, a name like that for you works out like, you know, when you're in a gym and they call the really, really big guy tiny, you know?
Yeah,
that,
exactly.
That's kind of
the irony of it.
Yeah, exactly. So in the end, it ends up being a cool nickname for you because you're obviously not a cupcake at all, but I mean that in the competitive sense.
Career, it's gotten me a lot of cupcakes. Like, people buy me cupcakes all the time, which is wonderful.
No, that's not good. That's not how an athlete eats. We're not supporting cupcake eating here.
But I do on occasion.